morning, church. Good morning. There's no better way to start worship than to sing the Lord's words back to Him. Would you stand with me this morning? And we're going to begin with Psalm 42, verse 1, which is the verse that this song was taken from. Read it with me, please. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. Psalm 42, verse 1. This time of year, with the weather we've had, it's easy for us to visualize that verse of Scripture. The thirst, the raging thirst, the desire for our souls to be filled with water is the way David says our souls should be filled with the Lord Himself. Would you sing with me, please? As the deer.
You are Lord, my rock, desire, and my Lord, to worship Thee. You are Lord, my strength, my shield. have experienced the faithfulness of God recently, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Good. That's awesome. Have a seat if you would. What an awesome reminder this morning in song that we sing and we come this morning to worship a faithful God. You know, faithfulness and consistency is something that's lacking in our world today, in our culture. We don't have as much faithfulness. You know, we usually eat at the same restaurants because we know that they're going to be consistent, because many times we're looking for something that is consistent, that is true, and that is faithful. And what a reminder that every time we come and gather together to worship, we worship a faithful God, a Savior who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So thank you for singing that this morning, church. When you came in this morning, you received a worship guide. I want everybody in here to pick up the worship guide that you received this morning. We haven't done this in a while, but I want everybody in here to pick it up. And on the end, there's a little tear-off tab, and I want every single person to tear that off right now, okay? Everybody tear that off. And I want you to do something with this connection card this morning, okay? There's two things that I need from you. If you're a guest with us today, first of all, let me say thank you for coming and worshiping with us here at Central Park. We are honored to have you here, and we're glad that you are here to worship the Lord with us this morning. And we want to get a little information about you, so if you could put your name on that card, give us a cell phone number, an email address, some way that we can connect with you. Thank you again for visiting with us and get more information to you about the church. And put that in the offering plate at the end of the service. We would appreciate that. But if you're a member or a regular attender, and it's been a while since you filled one of these things out, if there's been a change recently and maybe some information, maybe I know that one of the things that we come across all the time is we get ready to call someone. We don't have a cell phone number. We don't have an email address for them. So if you want to update that information, we would love that as well. But the other thing that I want for you is I want for you, if you would today, to put down one thing that we as a church can pray for you about right now. Maybe it's a struggle that you're going through in your personal life. Maybe it's an illness that's going on in your family. Maybe it's just something that you've been discouraged about recently that we can pray for you about. We collate these and we pass them out amongst our staff. We share some of these during our Wednesday night prayer time when we gather together as a faith family to pray. But everybody needs something at some point in time that we can pray for. And so if you would write down a prayer request and put that in there, if you don't want to put your name on it, you want to be anonymous, that's fine. If you want to put your name on that, let us know how we can pray specifically for you. And put that in the offering plate at the end so we know how to pray for you this morning. All right? Things are about to get really wild around here in the next 24 hours as we are about to enter into one of my favorite times of the year, Vacation Bible School. In less than 24 hours, this place will have a whole bunch of children in here with a lot of energy and a bunch of adults that will be working alongside of them to help show them and demonstrate and communicate the gospel to them. And so we want to pray for our Vacation Bible School this morning. And a couple of things that we want to kind of let you know about are things that you can help us out with. One, we're going to have a cookout tonight, just kind of a faith family cookout as a church. We got a lot of people that are going to be working up here this afternoon doing decorations and going to be really busy. Got a lot of things that are going on. And so rather than come in here tonight and try to have a worship service tonight, what we're going to do is have a cookout. We're going to grill some hamburgers and hot dogs. We're going to meet out in the Outback. If you don't normally come on Sunday night, this would be a great night to come because you're going to get a free meal if you come. And we're going to eat together and just fellowship with one another, but also have a strategic time of prayer for our Vacation Bible School. So if you can come with us tonight at 5:30 for the cookout, we would love to have you here. We need to know about how many are coming. We're making preparations for about 100. Many of you probably are planning on coming but haven't signed anything up. If you are planning on coming to our cookout today, would you just raise your hand so that we can kind of see that and just get an idea? Okay, that's about good. The rest of you go home and pray about it, and we'll see you at 5:30, okay? Nothing else going on tonight, trust me. So come and join us for our cookout tonight and help us out with that. Also, we want to show you a little video promo clip for our Vacation Bible School so you can see a little bit about what's going to be happening this week and be praying for our children and praying for our adults. So let's watch that video if we could. Would you join me in prayer over our Vacation Bible School? God, we come to you this morning as a church, and we just pray in the next few moments, in the next 24 hours, as children begin to come into this place and as they begin to seek you and begin to hear the stories about who you are and what you've done for us. God, we pray that every single heart that is in this place, that the seeds of the gospel will be planted in their hearts. And God, that you will bring those seeds to fruition in due season. And so, Father, we pray for our workers. We pray that you would give them clarity and energy, and God, help them to just love on these children this week. We pray for those that will be teaching the Bible stories, that they'll teach God's word with clearness and in such a way that our children will receive that. We pray for our children, God, that you will help them to know how much you love them and the plan that you have for their life. And so we just lift up our Vacation Bible School this morning to you. And we pray for ourselves this morning as we're here at church, God. We need to hear from you this morning. So Holy Spirit, would you speak to us? Would you come and not only empower the songs that we sing, but would you speak to us this morning from your word? And God, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your faithful hand has led us in the past. Your grace has guided those who've gone before. Our great foundation stood upon your name, and through your strength we've weathered every storm. Though we once could say in God we trust, Lord, you know how far we've fallen and turned the other way from your great love. Bring us back to where
Indeed, the call of the gospel is to turn from sin and devote our hearts, our lives, our work to the work of the Holy Spirit. One of the keys of the gospel is that Christ saved us, it says in Titus 3:5. Christ saved us not because of righteous works that we had done, but because of his great mercy. We sang just a moment ago from Lamentations that his mercies are indeed new every morning. The new every morning mercies of the Lord save us. The Bible says we're to be continually working out that salvation, continually striving to serve him, to be a part of who and what he wants each of us to be. This week we'll be trying hard to allow the Holy Spirit fertile ground to work among our children. We covet your prayers for Bible school this week because we serve a wonderful, merciful Savior whose mercies are new each day. Would you stand? We'll sing this great hymn. It's hymn number 162 in your hymnal there. Wonderful, merciful Savior.
Church, I hope that you've brought two things with you this morning. I hope you brought with you a copy of God's Word and a heart that is ready to receive that this morning. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 15, and so I'm going to ask you to open up to Luke chapter 15, and we're going to read that text in just a second. Let me go ahead and let you know that we have a special guest that will be coming next Sunday morning. Many of you are familiar with Todd and Susan Lafferty from their time staying in our mission house when they served as missionaries with the International Mission Board several years ago. And so our church has maintained a good relationship with Todd and Susan, even though they really kind of were just Central Park people when they were home on furlough. Todd recently went to be the chief operating officer and executive vice president for the International Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention. Reached out to Todd a few weeks ago and said, "Hey, brother, next time you're in town, would love to grab a cup of coffee, get to know a little bit, even if you're here on a Sunday, have you just share with our people at Central Park." And he said, "Well, I'm going to be in town on June the 9th for the beginning of the Southern Baptist Convention." And so we have the extreme honor of being able to have Todd come and speak to us next Sunday morning. I want to ask you to mark that on your calendar and be here. It's not very often that you have an opportunity to hear from someone who represents us at 47,000 Southern Baptist churches through the International Mission Board. And he's going to be sharing next Sunday morning a little bit about what God has been doing in his life and a little bit about what's going on with global missions through our International Mission Board. So please be here for that next Sunday morning. It is going to be a great time, and I know that you will not want to miss out on that. All right? So with that in mind, we are continuing this morning in our series on the parable of Jesus. And this morning we're going to be looking at one of the most familiar and most beloved of all of Jesus' parables. I dare say, when I announced several weeks ago that during the summer we're going to be looking at the parables of Jesus, many of us who've been Christians for a while instantly thought probably about this particular parable in Luke chapter 15. It's probably the most familiar of all of Jesus' stories, often known as the parable of the prodigal son. Even people who seldom attend church are very familiar with this story. They know the story of a passionate young man who demands from his father an early inheritance, wastefully spends his money, eventually hits hard times, and then goes home thinking that he's going to experience the harshness of his father only to experience the loving, tender embrace of his father. Quite honestly, it sounds like the narrative and a plot out of a hit Christian movie or something we might see on the Hallmark Channel. And while this parable is very familiar to many of us, while we've heard it, read it, know much about it, reality is that familiarity is not always a good thing. Because the true meaning of this parable is often obscured by our familiarity on it. And we often miss out because we focus primarily on the story of the parable of the son, the prodigal. That's where most of our attention goes in the story. As a matter of fact, that's what it's often referred to. It's what it says in my Bible. There's a little heading there that says the parable of the prodigal son. But it's not just a parable about a prodigal son. As a matter of fact, it's a parable about two sons. And it's not just a parable about two sons. It's a parable about a loving, gracious father. And so I've entitled this today, The Parable of Lost Boys and a Loving Father, because that's really what the entire story is about. Let's read the parable, and then I want to set the scene for you so that we can better understand it this morning. Jesus says in Luke chapter 15, verse 11, Jesus said to them, "There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the property that is coming to me.' And so the father divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went out and hired himself to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. No one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to the father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to the father, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But before he could get to that last part about treating him as one of the hired servants, the father interrupts him. The father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him back safe and sound. That's good news. That's the gospel. Verse 28, but the older son was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, look, these many years I have served you. I have never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fatted calf for him. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. Beautiful, beautiful story. I preached this parable in a series I preached through Luke several years ago. I actually preached it three times. I preached it from the perspective of all three of these characters because there's so much richness in this parable that we can discern, but today I'm going to preach an overview of all of these characters. And it's, as I said, a very familiar story, one that we've read many times, know about. As we're reading the story, many of you have heard it so many times, you're filling in the gaps as we're reading it. But it's important for us to remember that Jesus, again, doesn't just give us parables as moral fables. He doesn't just give us stories in the Bible so that we can separate them and read them and do a Sunday school lesson on them or do a flannel graph with our children and take this one parable outside of the context of where Luke places it in this narrative. We cannot separate the parables of Jesus from their context. And while this parable stands alone as a beautiful story of grace, it is actually one of three parables that Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 15. It's the third of three that he tells in consecutive order. And so it's important, actually, when we're reading this parable, to read it in the context of all three of those. And I won't do that, but the first of those parables is the parable of a man, a shepherd, who owned 100 sheep and one of them went missing. And so he leaves the 99 sheep in the field and goes out after the one lost sheep and finds it and brings it back and throws a party. And then there's a parable about a woman who had 10 coins and she lost one of those coins. And when she did, she frantically began to search the house until she found it. When she found that coin, she brings all of her neighbors over and throws a party because she found this coin. And then this story of this lost boy who comes home. The common theme in all three of these parables is this: something of incredible value has been lost, and when it is recovered, the owner or the master of that thing rejoices with a massive celebration. That's the common theme in all three of these stories. Something of immense value is lost, and when it is found, when it is recovered, there is a celebration because what was lost is now found. That's the main theme of this parable. And so why does Jesus tell this parable this way? Why does he tell these three parables? Well, he does so in response to a critical comment that was made by the Pharisees and the scribes at the beginning of Luke chapter 15. So these verses won't be on the screen, but if you have a Bible, go back and look at Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 2. This is important for us to understand why Jesus tells us the parable of the prodigal son. The Bible says, the tax collectors and the sinners were all drawing near to hear him, Jesus. So get the picture there. Jesus is going about his ministry, and as he's going about his ministry, the dregs of society begin to come near to hear him. The outcast, the tax collectors who were really traitors to their own government, who were collecting taxes for an occupying army and government that they didn't want there, those tax collectors began to come to hear about Jesus and the kingdom of God. The sinners, the people who had questionable reputations in the community, the people who had spent their life living their lives wasting away for the wrong things, began to come to hear this man, Jesus. And that should be good news, except it's not good news to the religious keepers of the day. And so verse 2 says, as the tax collectors and sinners are drawing near, the Pharisees and the scribes begin to grumble, saying, this man receives sinners and even eats with them. This man receives sinners, and he even has the audacity to sit down and share a meal with them. This was a derision. This was a criticism of Jesus, because the act of sharing table fellowship in Jewish society was one of high honor. When you sat down to eat a meal, it said something about the value that you place on the people that you were eating with, and religious leaders of the day would not stoop themselves to go and have a lunch or a dinner with someone as offensive as a tax collector, and certainly not a prostitute. And so as what we see here is Jesus responding to that accusation by telling these three parables, in which the common theme of all of them is that something of immense value has been lost. And when it is found and recovered, there is an incredible celebration. It's a picture of the gospel. As we read this parable, it revolves around three central characters who are each very important to the narrative, and each one represents someone. Each one represents someone in this room today. I dare say that every one of us in here have been one of these two brothers at one point in time, if we're not currently. And so who are these three characters? Well, the first of these three characters is the lost son, or the prodigal son. The bulk of the text is devoted to this journey of this younger son. And you know the story. We see him take a journey from a position of privilege. He was the son of a wealthy landowner, the context seems to suggest, a man who was a man of means, a man of well respect within his community, and he's the younger son. And we see him take a journey from this position of privilege to one of a hopelessly desperate situation. In a foreign land, without any resources, stooping himself to the lowest task of society, that of feeding the pigs, and even being so incredibly destitute that he would consider the slop that the pigs were eating as something that would be appealing to him. And we see him take that journey from privilege to desperation, and then back to reconciliation and restoration. The lost son is a representative of a large portion of our world today. People who are created in the image of God, people who are loved dearly by God the Father, people who are blessed to be living in the Father's sovereign world, and yet their lives are marked by selfishness, immaturity, impulsiveness, and rebellion. The younger son is a picture of impulsive, immature, and rebellious living. The son doesn't even want to be recognized as a child of the Father. Instead, he wants to cash out on his connection with the Father in order to live life on his terms. He wants to be a self-made man. He wants to pursue what he wants, and he wants to pursue it when he wants it. He's a rebel. I don't want to be defined any longer by anyone else's terms. I want to live life on my terms. And when the son actually makes the request to his father to give him the portion of the inheritance that's coming to him, he is in essence telling the father that he wants to sever all earthly relationship with the father. Basically, when the son makes that request, he's saying to his father, you are worth more to me dead than alive. Go ahead and treat me as though you were already dead and give me what's coming to me, because I want to do it my way. And you likely know the rest of the story. He leaves town to pursue travel in a foreign land and to enjoy the excesses of what the Bible calls reckless living. And very soon he has squandered all the money lost all the friends and has nothing left to show for it. The prodigal's story is an important reminder to us of this truth, that the pursuit of sin never brings true satisfaction, and ultimately it will take from us until we have nothing left. The pursuit of sin never brings true and lasting satisfaction, and ultimately it will take from us everything we have until we have nothing left. Many of you know that because many of you have experienced that in your life. Many of you at one point in time lived the life of the prodigal. And you thought you were living life on your terms. You thought you were pursuing freedom. You thought you were living life to the fullest, only to find that every single day that you night that you put your head on the pillow, you left not with a feeling of satisfaction, but with a greater sense of emptiness. And after coming to his senses, this younger son realizes that the servants in his father's house have it better off than him. It would be better to go back and hire himself out as a slave to his father than to stay in a foreign land feeding the pigs. He knows he has absolutely no rights to come back as a son, but he would rather hire himself out to be a servant than to continue to live in the situation that he's in. And so he swallows his pride and begins the humiliating and painful journey home to face the music, where he encounters the second character in the story, which is the loving father. In reality, this parable is not the story of two sons, it's the story of a loving father, because he's the center of the story. A successful landowner with two sorry sons, one who has told him in essence that he wants absolutely nothing to do relationally with him. And yet even when that son comes with that audacious request to say, "Father, just give me what's coming to me because I'd rather go do it my way than stay here under your house and wait for you to die." In that moment, that father does not disown that son. He does not condemn that son. He does not shame him. He does not criticize him. Philip Ryken writes in his commentary on Luke that the father responds to an unreasonable request with unimaginable generosity. He responds to an incredibly unreasonable request with unimaginable generosity. And can you imagine what it was like for this father to know exactly what was in this young boy's heart? He'd been raising him all of his life. He knew how impetuous he was. He knew how impulsive he was. He knew how he had this continual tendency to pursue things that weren't the best for him. And yet instead of shaming him, he gives the son exactly what he asked for, even though ultimately he knows it will ruin him. Likewise, our Heavenly Father loves us tremendously. But one of the things we must remember about our Heavenly Father is He does not prevent us from experiencing the consequences of pursuing our sinful hearts. Our Heavenly Father does not prevent us from the consequences of pursuing the sin in our hearts. As a matter of fact, like the Father in this story, He is patient and graceful and ultimately forgiving when we would repent and return to him, but he does not stop the son from pursuing sin. Then thirdly, we see the elder brother. Most of the time when we read or tell the parable of the prodigal son, we completely leave the elder brother off. You see, Jesus doesn't end the story with the return of the prodigal son and the father's embrace. That would be a great Hallmark moment. But instead, he includes the story of the elder brother, because the elder brother is a picture of the Pharisees and the scribes that we read about in chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Jesus includes them in the story because he's responding directly to them, and he's showing them that while sinners are coming to salvation in Jesus, these keepers of the religious order cannot even rejoice in the celebration that what was lost is found, because they're the bitter, self-righteous, proud, and arrogant older brother. The older brother comes in from the field and hears the sound of music and celebration. He inquires of a servant what's going on and finds out that this irresponsible, rebellious younger brother has returned home. And if you're reading this story like me, if you're the older brother in this story, you're thinking to yourself, well, I'm glad he came home because now dad can finally give him what's coming to him, right? That's what we're all expecting. Man, I want to sit in on that family meeting. And I want to hear dad lay into him and say, how dare you have the audacity to come back after saying what you said to me and wasting your life in sinful ways. But instead of hearing that, he hears the sound of music in celebration. And instead of feeling joy that his lost brother is home, he gets angry and pouts and refuses to join the party. One of the reasons why is because in that society, as the elder brother and as the one who was the rightful heir, it would actually have been his responsibility to serve as the master of ceremonies for the party. So he would have been the one responsible for making sure that the party kept going and that there was plenty of food and wine and dancing and revelry. And he's so angry, he's refusing to go in and even take what is his rightful responsibility. And it's important to understand that when the younger brother refuses to go into the party, his refusal is just as much of an insult to the father as the younger son's initial request for money was. He's saying, I don't want to live life on your terms, Dad. Again, the father does not come out to condemn, to criticize, or to demean the older son. He patiently listens to the harsh criticism of his younger son and then graciously reminds him that everything that belongs to the father already belongs to him. And he reminds him and us that the right thing to do is to celebrate when a lost son or daughter returns to the father's house and the father's love. The right thing to do is to celebrate when a lost son or daughter returns to the father's house. And this story points out two things that keep us from experiencing God's love in our life. Two things that really keep us from fully experiencing the love of God. One of those is our sinful indulgence. That's where we rightfully see the story of the parable of the prodigal son. Many of us can relate to his story because we've walked that journey ourselves. Many of us have seen family members who have lived lives of prodigal living or maybe are still doing so, and they live their lives in selfish, self-centered indulgence that will not lead them to desire God nor salvation in Jesus Christ. You see, when we allow ourselves to be controlled by the selfish lust of our hearts, they will always take us deeper into sin and further away from the love of our Heavenly Father. When we allow ourselves to be pursued by selfish indulgence, it will always take us deeper into the pursuit of sin and further away from the Father's love. As one old preacher famously said, sin will take you farther than you want to go, keep you longer than you plan to stay, and cost you more than you want to pay. And millions of people in our world live for nothing today more than the personal indulgence of their sinful hearts. They want to live life on their terms and not on any other's terms, including God. And like the younger son, they may pretend to even have a relationship to the Father, but the true condition of their heart is they are rebellious sinners who do not belong to God. And selfish indulgence will take you away from experiencing the Father's love. But there's something else that will take you away from experiencing the love of the Father, and that is our self-righteousness. Our self-righteousness will take us away from experiencing the unconditional love of our Father just as much as our selfish indulgence. And self-righteousness is a pride in our own goodness and performance that will blind us to our daily need for grace and forgiveness. And this is what happens when we begin to define our relationship to the Father on the basis of our performance and our personal merit rather than God's love for us. This is the sin of Phariseeism. And this is what happens when eventually we refuse to celebrate the grace of God towards sinners. And it's what happens in the church when we choose to define people by their sinful choices rather than by God's love for them. I found that the longer I've been in the church, the more I tend to be an elder brother. And the more I tend to see people by the marking of the sinful choices that they've made in life rather than the unconditional love of God for them. And the reality is that sinful indulgence and self-righteousness are both deadly spiritual cancers that will destroy your relationship with God and ultimately lead you away from Him. And the cure for the indulgent heart and the cure for the self-righteous heart is the absolute same thing, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The only thing that can cure and overcome a sinful, indulgent heart, and the only thing that can overcome a self-righteous heart is the merciful, gracious love of God that we see in this parable. You see, I told you when we started this that every parable has one central point. Lots of applications, but one central point. So what's the point of the parable of the prodigal son? The point is this, that God is a merciful, patient and tender God who never stops looking for the lost and rejoices over true repentance. That's the whole point of this parable. It's the reason why Jesus tells these three stories, and it's the reason why he lays it down so hard in this third parable, is because what he wants the Pharisees to understand and what he wants us as his children to understand is that our God in heaven is a merciful, patient and tender God who never stops looking for the lost. Never. And he rejoices every time that he sees true repentance. You see, God's mercy is wide enough to forgive and receive both prodigals and the proud, and his love is strong enough to overcome all of our sin and failure. In Jesus' day, the religious gatekeepers had neglected what God's word said about God's grace and mercy and instead had created a rules-based system that kept score on their personal righteousness. And because of that, these religious gatekeepers rejected the very people that needed the hope of the gospel the most. And Jesus' parable absolutely shattered their perception of God and shows them that God never stops seeking and saving the lost. Why did Jesus eat with tax collectors and sinners? Because it's exactly what God would do. God is a merciful, patient, and tender God who never stops looking for the lost. And I hope that that's good news for you today. Because some of you may be still trying to find your way back to the Father, and you may have thought, God gave up on me a long time ago. But the reality of it is that God hasn't given up on you. You may have given up on God, but God hasn't given up on you. I'm so grateful, even in my own personal life, that God didn't give up on me. I became a Christian when I was 18, 19 years old. And my father, who lived a life on his own terms for much of my life, God never gave up on him until he was well into his 50s before he became a follower of Jesus Christ. There are three critical reminders that I kind of points of application I want us to take away from this parable today. In addition to the main point of the parable, there are three things I see that I think are important for us to look at. Number one, it's easier oftentimes to see the prodigal in others than it is to see the prodigal in the mirror. Now, I heard a pastor one time say, if you can't say amen, you need to say oh my. And that's the reality of life, is that oftentimes it's easier to see the prodigal in others than it is to see the prodigal in the mirror standing before us. You see, one of the most important parts of this story is that it's our story, because all of us at one time have been the prodigal son. The tendency of our fallen sinful nature is to deceive ourselves about the reality of our sinful condition. But if we do an honest assessment, just like the prodigal son, many of us are more lost than we like to admit. Most of the time when people read this parable, they picture someone else in the role of the prodigal. They picture a child or a spouse or a coworker or that bum on the street that they passed last week. But the truth is that all of us have hearts that have desired to leave the Father and pursue the sinful indulgence of our own hearts. And some of us had the tendency to focus on the reckless living of this boy and excuse ourselves because we don't live a wild life like him, but we forget that it isn't the outward manifestations of our sin that are the problem, but the fact that this boy openly rejected the Father's love and the Father's authority over him in order to live life on his terms. You don't have to to be a public humiliation feeding pigs in a foreign land to be a prodigal who has turned your back on the Father in order to live life on your own terms. And it's important, as we said earlier, that we see that this is a story about two prodigal boys, both of whom are lost, both of whom who have rejected the Father, both of whom have lived in rebellion, one in clear open rebellion and the other in years of inward rebellion. And the problem with the elder brother is that he could clearly see the sin of his brother, but he couldn't see the sin in his own heart. And instead, he was judgmental, critical, bitter, and just as greedy at the end of the day as his younger brother was. And I have learned that religious hypocrisy is the most deadliest of all cancers because it's so often harder to see. The sins in the church are much more refined and buried within deep layers of religious goodness and works. But the truth is that the church is often filled with elder brothers who are just as lost but cover the spiritual reality behind a veil of religiosity. Whether you are a wanton, prodigal, or hypocritical Pharisee, the greatest need that you have is for the gospel and to return to the love of your heavenly Father. The second reality that we see here and reminder is that when we are lost and hit rock bottom, what we need is not to try harder, but to run to the unconditional love of our God. You see, when we are lost and we've hit rock bottom, what we need is not to get more religious. You've heard this before. How many times have you talked to somebody who's kind of living the life of a prodigal and they're making bad choices and they're suffering the consequences of that? They're kind of in a pig pen and you can see it and you say to them, why don't you come to church with me? How can I pray for you? Why don't you come join me at church on Sunday? And what do they always say? Well, I want to, but I need to get right before I go back to church, right? How many of you heard that before? I need to get cleaned up. I need to start making better choices. No, you need to go to God's house and you need to be where the gospel is preached, not because you need to get your act right before you come, but because you can't get your act right. Because you need the gospel. You don't need to try harder. You need to run to the unconditional love of your Father. And one of the things that make this parable such a beloved parable is the beautiful picture of redemption and restoration. And what the younger son saw as freedom and pleasure eventually becomes a snare and a prison to him. And he couldn't sink any lower than being a foreign Jew who hires himself out to feed pigs and to be so hungry that he would actually desire to eat what the pigs ate. But then verse 17 contains a very important phrase. It says, when he came to himself. This is a moment of awakening. It's a moment that for the first time in his life, this young boy finally begins to get clarity. He finally begins to understand that he wasn't created to feed pigs in a foreign land. He was born the child of the Father. And while he didn't deserve restoration, it would be better to be a slave on his father's farm than a servant in some foreign land. And currently, there are thousands of people who still live under the delusion that they have everything under control, that a change of circumstances is just around the corner. And what they don't know is what they're doing is slopping pigs in a land they were never intended to be and thinking that something is going to change. Some of you have friends and loved ones that are like this. I know this is my story. It's the story of my family. And I didn't ask for permission to share it, but my brother battled addiction for many years. My family and my mom and we walked with him as he lived under the delusion that he had it all under control and that things were going to change real soon. That all he needed was just a little more time and things were going to change until eventually he hit rock bottom. He had exhausted all options and continued to destroy everything and everyone around him. And at that point, just like the prodigal, he finally came to himself and realized that everything that really mattered was right there all along, and everything that didn't, he had spent a lifetime pursuing. And I am so proud of my brother Brad that the love of God and the power of God's grace led him out of his pit and back to the unconditional love of God the Father. Perhaps you are a prodigal on that journey right now. You started down a road that promised you adventure and freedom, only to see that now you are beginning to experience emptiness and disillusionment and enslavement. I implore you, when you hit rock bottom, what you need is not to try harder, but to run to the unconditional love of your Heavenly Father. And then the third reminder here that this parable shows us is just simply this. No matter how far they go, and no matter how much they have done, the Heavenly Father receives all sinners who repent with mercy and grace. No matter how far you go, no matter how much you've done, if you will repent, the Heavenly Father receives all sinners with mercy and grace. As we said, this isn't the story of a lost boy. It's the story of a gracious and loving father who endures the scorn of his impetuous and spoiled sons, but never gives up on them and daily looks for his return, who shamelessly runs through the town to meet his shameful son, who doesn't condemn the sins of his son, but throws a party to celebrate his return, who lovingly reminds the ungrateful elder son of his love, and who receives both of these sinful boys with mercy and grace. This is, ladies and gentlemen, a picture of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this, sons and daughters of God, is the beauty of our God. That we do not have a capricious God who requires that we somehow prove our penance by public acts of shame and humility. We don't have a God who demands that we earn His love by the reality of our perfections. We don't have a God who writes off the prodigals when they spurn His love and they leave Him. We have a God who doesn't treat us with shame and contempt and reproach. Why? Because we have a God who bore the shame of our sin, the contempt of our rebellion, and the reproach of our humiliation on Himself when He sent His perfect, sinless Son to die on the cross for our sins. I was writing those words, and it reminded me of the hymn of George Bernard where he writes, "On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. The emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. Oh, that old rugged cross so despised by the world has a wondrous attraction to me. For the dear Lamb of God left His glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. In the old rugged cross stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. For the dear Lamb of God left His glory above to pardon and sanctify me. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then He'll call me someday to my home far away where His glory forever I'll cheer. So I'll what? Cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross, and one day I will exchange it for a crown." The beauty of this parable is that the loving and gracious Father receives both His prodigal and His judgmental Son with mercy and grace, because our God is a God that no matter how far we go and no matter what we've done, He's a God who receives all sinners who would repent and trust in Jesus with mercy and grace. How many of you like parties? Anybody like parties? Okay. See, you guys are too Baptist. Okay. I know Wendy Brandon likes parties. I went to a party last night. Went to a wedding, and after the wedding had a reception and saw this couple and all of their families celebrating this momentous occasion. And we had a party. We had a feast. Thank you, Dave Witten, for paying for that feast, by the way. We had a good time. Some of our ladies had more of a good time than they should have, probably. No, I'm just kidding. But don't you like going to a party? I like going to a party. Do you know when heaven throws a party? Let me tell you something. Heaven doesn't throw a party when you get up in the morning and get your Bible and your cup of coffee and take your little Instagram post and post it up there and say, "Having my quiet time this morning." Heaven doesn't throw a party for that. It's not a bad thing. It's just that heaven doesn't throw a party when you have your quiet time. Heaven doesn't throw a party when you do everything right. Heaven doesn't throw a party because you showed up at church this morning. You know when heaven throws a party? The Bible says heaven throws a party every single time that a lost sinner comes home to the Father. That's when heaven throws a party. And you know what? I want to see more parties in heaven. I'd like to see a party in heaven today. Because perhaps today there's a prodigal who's been living in a foreign land, away from the Father for a long time, and you finally hit rock bottom and you don't know where else to turn, let me just encourage you, what God wants from you is not for you to try harder today. What God wants from you is not to hide behind a religious veil and act like everything's okay. What God wants for you is to come to your senses and say, it's a lot better in my Father's house than it is in this pig pen, and to come home to the Father today. Or perhaps you're one of those older brothers who's just kind of hid behind a veil of self-righteousness, fooling yourself that you've got it all together. In reality, you need the gospel just as much as your prodigal brother does. And maybe today you just need to come and put down that veil of hypocrisy and religiosity and just say, you know what? I need to come back to the unconditional, all-giving love of my Heavenly Father. In just a moment, we're going to sing a song of response. We'll give you an opportunity to respond to the gospel today. So whether you're a prodigal or whether you're an elder brother, today your greatest need is the gospel of Jesus Christ, to repent and trust in Him. And so in just a moment, as we sing this song, if you need to give your life to Christ, or if you just need to come this morning and you just need to kneel here and say, God, I need you just to do a work in my heart right now because my heart's not been where it needs to be. In just a moment, we want to give you the opportunity to do that. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? In just a moment, when I get done praying, David's going to lead us in a song of response. You respond as the Lord Jesus leads you today. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we thank you that you are a good, merciful, and faithful Father who never gives up on the lost and rejoices over repentance. So this morning, would you grant some this morning to experience repentance? Would you call the prodigal this morning to step out of that pig pen and to begin to walk forward to his Father's house? Would you call that elder brother to stop seething on the outside in his own righteousness and to come in and enjoy the party? Would you do a work in our hearts this morning, Lord Jesus? And we will thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand, sing, and respond as the Lord leads you?
Have thine own way.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for today. Father, we thank you for the message that we heard, Lord, that no matter how we mess up, Lord, you still love us. Thank you for your unconditional love so much, Lord, that you sent your Son to die on the cross for our sins. I pray, Lord, especially for this week's VBS, that you be with the workers, the volunteers, the kids, and that someone will accept you as their personal Savior. Bless this offering and let it do good for everything it needs to do. Forgive us for our sins. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Of crimson, God.
His love on a hillside so long, long ago. For you and for me, Jesus died, and love's greatest story was told. I love you.
I love you.
Couldn't go any farther than at the head of the road, which is right there at 166 and 100 meet. And I parked my car in somebody's yard over there, and I said, I'm going to the house, you know, and I tug out running. There must have been 500 trees down, and I climbed every one of them and finally made it here. And first thing I did was I come over here and looked at the back porch was, and that side of the house was still there. So I'm like, "Well," and I peeked around here and the porch was still here. I looked on the porch and I'm like, everything is still there. It's like the plants are still there. Everything, nothing moved. It was like the house wasn't even in a tornado. It wasn't even in storm. And I'm like, good heavens. But we had that little dog outside. And my wife was on the phone, you know, I was trying to tell her about the destruction. And I was standing on the back porch there. And I said, well, it looks like the house made it, but our little dog, Boog, was in the pen. And I said, there's no way that little dog survived. I said, he's got to be crushed over one of them logs. I said, there's 100 logs there, huge ones. And she's, oh no, you know. And so I turned around to start walking over here and here comes a little dog. Hey. Wagging his little tail, how are you, you know? And it's unbelievable, he didn't get a scratch on him. Not a scratch. So that was a miracle in itself, but I think the shock of seeing every single thing tore down, except the house, and I just stood there, like, how could that happen? That was a miracle for miracles. I mean, this house took 200 mile an hour winds and didn't move nothing. It's like, how does that happen? It's incredible the people that will do something for you when a disaster hits, you know? And I never realized it would be that way. I figured we'd be stuck in here for the next 20 years trying to chop them way out, you know? It really touched my heart that all these people, including you guys, have such a big heart and soul to come out here and do all this. Nothing said you had to. You know, it's because you want to and want to help other people. And it's just, it's overwhelming. It's absolutely overwhelming.
For our Vacation Bible School offering this year, we're giving money to help support the work of our Alabama disaster relief workers. And so we want you to pray over that ministry. And we have some information that's available in the back right outside those doors about Southern Baptist disaster relief work. Perhaps you've been thinking about possibly being involved and be able to be mobilized when there's an emergency or when there's a critical situation like there was in Beauregard. And the best way to do that is through our Alabama Baptist Disaster Relief. So there's some information about that. Our kids are going to be learning about that work all week long. And then we're also going to be taking up an offering. And also you can give to that offering next week to help support that as well. So continue to pray for that ministry. We'll see you tonight at the cookout at 5:30. David, lead us out.
Be dismissed. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.